नमस्ते, हमेशा खुश रहो बिटिया। दिस इज जेवी डॉक्टर राकेश शर्मा, प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑर्गेनल ऑफ मेडिसिन एंड होम्योपैथिक फिलोसॉफी। आवर टुडे सेशन इज कैरोल डनहम फिलोसॉफी चैप्टर 3, रिलेशन ऑफ पैथोलॉजी टू थेरेप्यूटिक्स। इट्स फंक्शंस आर परफॉर्म्ड आफ्टर ए न्यू फैशन। द ऑर्गन्स आर नॉट ससेप्टिबल टू द वांटेड स्टिमुलाई अप्लाइड अकॉर्डिंग टू द लॉज ऑफ हाइजीन। The organism has passed from a state of health into one of permanent disease. The general stimuli, which modified and balanced under the laws of hygiene, this new law, whatever it be, is the therapeutic law. And these new stimuli are therapeutic agents, and the study of the law and the agents constitute the science of therapeutics. Having thus marked out its limits, we have next to inquire what the nature of any possible science of therapeutics must be. Its subject is the modified functions and organs of the body. Its agents are special stimuli drawn from whatever region of the external world. In accordance with this method, the subject of his researches will be respectively the phenomena manifested by the patient and the phenomena produced by the special stimulus, and his endeavor must be to discover a general formula which shall express a constant relation between these two series of phenomena and shall never pass the therapeutic law. The therapeutist then, abandoning all idea of constructing a science of therapeutics on the rational method, must have recourse to the empirical, as the elaborators of other natural science have done. The elements of his science will be as follows. He has to deal with a subject known by its phenomena, the sick body, with an agent known also by its phenomena, the drug, and with a law which shall tell how to apply agent to the subject for the accomplishment of a cure. A law which shall express the general relation between the drug and the morbid organism. The following tabular statement will show more clearly the nature of therapeutics as a science and its harmony with other natural sciences. For every inductive natural science, except those of classification, consists elementarily of two series of independent phenomena connected by the formula of their general relation. The conditions for a science or therapeutics. We come now to consider two conditions to which every man's science must be subject, and which may therefore nerve as test of its fitness to be regarded as a science. The first of these is a capability of infinite progress in each of its elements without detriment to its integrity as a whole. In the science of optics, again, the phenomena of the luminous body and those of the light receiving body are connected by the law of transmission and diffusion of light. This structure of the science and all that is based upon it rests undisturbed through all the mighty changes which recent discoveries have wrought in our knowledge of optics, enriched but now revolutionized by them. But while the progress of the science has been thus rapid and uninterrupted, philosophers have been and remain at variance respecting the very nature of light and its mode of propagation. One school holds to the theory of emission, another of the undulatory theory. Now let us suppose that the science of optics, instead of being based upon an empirical law, the result of induction and which expresses the relation between two series of observed phenomena, and had been based upon a theory of the essential nature of light and its mode of transmission. This furnishes an exact illustration of what would be the history of any science of therapeutics not constructed upon the empirical plan already elaborated. Let us suppose that instead of taking as the subject of action the phenomena of disease has derived from observation with all the aid which auxiliary sciences can afford. We should take a theory of disease, its essential nature and mode of development, and upon this theory should construct a science. All would go well until facts should show that our theory was insufficient and unattainable. Now our whole structure would be over, or nor would the fragments even be available for the construction of another science or another theory. Or they would consist of observations made not independently but on the basis of a theory and with reference to it. By all means, investigate and theorize just as physicists do upon the nature, properties and transmission of light, but do it as studying the science of pathology, not that of therapeutics, and avoid most carefully making these theories, which can be at best no more than temporary aids to the observation and grouping of phenomena, the basis of a practical science. If, however, they throw light on the study of phenomena, render our observations of them more keen and more exact, or afford us connecting links between isolated groups of phenomena, and they will do all this. They will render valuable indirect aid to the science of therapeutics, just as similar investigations of light have advanced our knowledge of optics. But to predict what has not been observed is to attempt ourselves to use the legislative phrases of nature, and when she responds plainly and precisely to that which we thus utter, we cannot but suppose that we have in a great measure made ourselves masters of the meaning and structure of our language. The prediction of results even of the same kind as those which have been observed in new cases is a proof of real success in our inductive process. This session powered by digital version 2.0 Jyoti Vidyapeeth Women's University. I hope you are satisfied with